There
Yes,
was
yes, yes.
construction. I recall that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do recall that. And I also recall that there was a little pond or a lake in the middle
Yes, indeed.
with swans. Yes, I remember that
Yes.
very well.
That one is our president office, rector office. Yes.
Rector office, yes.
Okay,
You've
okay.
been there also, Richard, at the time.
Yes,
You see the
I had such a lovely visit with Professor Rosa and Professor Radian, and I met many people from the university, and I look forward to coming back, and we look forward to hosting Professor
Oh,
Rosa here.
yeah. Of course.
It's our pleasure to visit you. Currently, I work closely with two professors from Dallas, Professor Tashuan Feng and also Professor Mike Peng from my field management. So hopefully, when I visit them, I can visit Austin too.
Oh, please. Yes, that would be great. You know, we have an excellent school of management here,
Yes.
and I'm sure you'd like to meet them, and they'd like to meet you.
Okay.
It's great, yeah. I
Great.
hope that the pandemic will be over and we can travel again. We can,
Well, I hope so too. You know, I used to travel a lot, and I haven't been traveling at
yes,
all. I'm taking
I
my first
know.
flight. My first flight is on Tuesday, because
Oh, I
I'm
see.
going to Canada.
Next
That's my
Tuesday. Next
yeah, my that's
Tuesday.
my
Okay.
first flight in
16
maybe
months,
18 months. 18,
18 months.
yeah, 17, 18 months, yeah.
Yes.
Oh, it's a wonderful
So,
journey then.
how are you, Richard? How
I'm
are you?
well. I'm
Okay.
well. Yeah, very well. Thank you for asking. And it's really great to see you, Rosa. I know that
Thank
you're
you.
very busy, and I hope you're doing well, doing better than when we
Yeah,
exchanged
I'm doing
messages.
better right now. Actually, it's been a month after contracted with COVID, but yeah, I hope that it will be fine. Here
Hopefully.
is actually the trend is reduced with the COVID. So, but I don't know what happened next. I hope that we can get it managed, yeah. The Delta variant, the Delta strain is really like unpredictable.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Yeah, it's really devastating, and there's so much bad news happening around the world, not only with the pandemic, but Afghanistan and Haiti and
Yeah,
China.
I
There's
know.
so much
I know.
devastation. So I'm grateful for this opportunity to be with you and think about something that takes our mind off of the sadness in the world.
I know. So, Professor Badri, Professor Richard Albert is actually our visiting professor, right? This year.
Oh,
So,
thank
yeah,
you for
we hope
your
that.
support, Professor Albert.
Thank you. I wish the circumstances permitted a visit, but we'll have to wait for another time.
Yeah, maybe next year. Yeah, next
Yes,
year.
earlier for next year, I think.
Yeah, and let me just say thank you before we start. I want to thank you. I will thank you when we start, but I want to thank you privately now, Director Badri. For offering me an honorarium for this discussion. And I was asked to fill a form about the honorarium, and I asked that it be directed to the students. So
Okay.
I'm sure you will take care of that, but thank you very much. I would much prefer
Oh,
the honorarium to be invested back into the students. So thank you.
thank you, was our great. Thank you.
Thank you for your generosity, Richard. Yeah.
I think I would like to inform you too, Professor Albert, that currently our Master of Science in Law and Development has some high-ranking official actually, officials. Yes, the head of senator, Indonesian senator, also become the student in this program. So hopefully after you talk, maybe some of them can get some inspiration to make the constitution can support the development.
Amendment.
Wonderful. Well, thank you for that.
We actually going to, oh, Radian share the screen. Radian is here. I think you share the screen. Hello, Radian. Yeah, actually, Prof. Badri, actually, Richard and I taught a workshop. So, actually, on July, Richard, according to the schedule, but unfortunately, maybe, well, because of the COVID and the pandemic, I think it's no excuse for that. But yeah, the reality that it's very difficult for us. So, maybe for the next semester, we can reschedule again the workshop on constitutional amendment, yeah, Richard, yeah? So here also we have Radian. Maybe Radian want to say hi to Richard first. You are...
Hi, Professor Radian, good to see you.
How are you, Professor Richard?
I'm well, I'm really happy to see you. Thank you for being here and thank you for hosting me along with Professor Badri and Professor Rosa.
Thank you. Thank you for your kindness to give a lecture in this night, I think, in your time. Yeah.
Yes. It's now 9:07 here in in Austin, Texas. Yeah.
In Austin, okay. Yes. Okay. Shall we start now? Because I think like the participant has already in the Zoom right now. So I'm going to start with good morning and good evening in Austin. Richard, once again, thank you very much. It's an honor for us to see you again, sitting here, hearing your public lecture. And before you start, we have Professor Badri as our director of the postgraduate school, Universitas Airlangga. Maybe Professor Badri want to say a few words for us. Please, Professor Badri.
Thank you, Rosa, the Honorable Professor Richard Albert, the William Stamps Faris Professor in Law, Professor of Government and Director of Constitutional Studies at the University of Texas at Austin, our Vice Director, Head of Study Program, especially Master of Science in Law and Development, and the beloved students and participants. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh, and good morning everyone, and also good evening for Professor Albert. This public lecture on the next generation of constitutional design is the first lecture this semester. Of course, the objective is to expose students and participants to the field of research on the next constitutional design. And we wish our students and participants can understand the logic of the constitutional design and how to reconfigure and adapt to the changing world, especially how to speed up the transformation of Indonesia by developing constitutions that support the country's development. As Prof. Albert might aware that currently we are the seventh biggest economy in the world, and we expect in the 100th year of our independence, 2045, we will become an advanced or high economy country. Of course, this is a challenging task for Indonesia, since right now we have 1/4 of the minimum GDP per capita threshold. With the support of next generation of constitutional design, I believe we can optimize the next 24 years to come to make the collective ambition high income country will come true. So please give big applause to Professor Albert, Dr. Rosa, Dr. Radian, and all of the participants, particularly to our international partnership unit and our vice director who make this event happen successfully. So thank you and have a wonderful, enjoyable, and also insightful public lecture. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and good morning.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you, Professor Badri. And without further ado, I would like to invite Professor Richard Albert to starting his lecture on the special topic on the next generation of constitutional design. Please, Professor Richard.
Well, thank you so very much. I want to thank Airlangga University for inviting me to participate in this very special public lecture series, especially to inaugurate the series as the very first speaker. Thank you for that honor. I also want to say just how delightful it is for me to see my old friends, my dear friends, Professors Rosa and Radian. It's great to see you. Let me also thank Director of the Postgraduate School, Professor Bajri. Thank you for your kind remarks. Thank you for being here. I know you're very, very busy. And so for me, it's an honor to have your presence here. And I look forward to our time together now virtually, and then hopefully in person before too long. This opportunity that you've given me to speak with you about constitutional change is a reminder about just how much I love my job as a law professor. It's a job that I do here on the campus of the University of Texas at Austin. And the campus is located on the indigenous lands of the Tonkawa. And thanks to the careful stewardship of these grounds by the Tonkawa, today I get to live a life of learning and discovery. And so I honor the Tonkawa, and I ask you to join me in honoring them too. It's really a privilege to participate in this special public law series. It's an opportunity not only to meet all of you that I haven't met yet, but as I say, to see two of my dear colleagues at the Faculty of Law, Professors Rosa and Radian. I spent some time with them in November 2019 in Surabaya, and we have some ongoing collaborations now. We're working on a book on constitutional amendment together. Professors Rosa and Radian are writing a chapter on amendment in Indonesia that will go in our book about amendment in the world. And so the three of us share an interest in constitutional amendment. More generally, though, in constitutions and in constitutional design, it's a subject that I think is of evergreen importance. It never becomes unimportant. It's always important. And I think that it will only get more important in the future as people around the world take greater ownership of their own constitutions. I write about constitutional change and constitutional design, how constitutions are replaced, how they're created, how they're amended, how they're interpreted, and how they operate in both written and unwritten forms. I'm especially interested in the values of democracy and constitutionalism and the rule of law. These values as drivers of constitutional change and also of constitutional preservation. These values are sometimes in tension with each other, but they must always work together and try to reach some balance in order to generate durable constitutional regimes. We can look around the world to see these values in operation. Some constitutional systems are thriving, some are not, and many are somewhere in between. And so for me, this raises the question, where will we be in 30 years? Where will we be in 40 years? How will constitutional politics shape the next generations of constitutional design? In my remarks today, I'd like us to look to the world of tomorrow by asking three questions on the future of constitutional change, by asking what the future holds for constitutional design. And then you and I can discuss these ideas in connection with your constitution, the Constitution of Indonesia. So, three questions about the future of constitutional design. One, what role will democracy play in constitutional design? Two, how will constitutionalism and constitutional design manage the tension between the local and the global? Between national commitments at home and global values in the world? And third, what will the rule of law demand for a proper, valid, and legitimate process of constitutional revision? And so the title of my remarks is The Next Generation of Constitutional Design. Let's begin with the first theme, democracy in constitutional design in the world of tomorrow. Right now, we're in the midst of the age of the referendum. and that age will not soon end. In the last few decades, there has been a great proliferation of referendums in constitutional change around the world. Referendums have been used in every single region of the world. But we've seen the rise of a very peculiar kind of referendum. It's a constitutional referendum that is non-obligatory, that is discretionary, that is advisory. In other words, leaders around the world over the past decades have proposed changes to the Constitution, and they have sent those proposals to the people for their approval in a referendum, even though the Constitution does not require a referendum. I call these kinds of referendums discretionary referendums. Discretionary referendums are not contemplated by the Constitution, but leaders nonetheless hold them as part of the process of making major changes to the Constitution. And the question for us is why? Why would a leader do this, to hold a discretionary, non-obligatory referendum? Well, one reason is to overcome political resistance. Political actors may be unwilling to consent to a reform that a leader believes is necessary, so the leader invokes the idea of a referendum as a threat that the leader will go over the heads of the resistance and directly to the people. So this is an offensive strategy to break down political barriers that stand in the way of a reform. This is what happened in France in 1962, when President Charles de Gaulle circumvented the obstructionist parliament with a national discretionary referendum. Another reason why leaders hold discretionary referendums is the opposite of the offensive strategy that we saw in France. It is instead used as a defensive strategy to give political cover or to get advice for an important or controversial choice that political actors want to make. And so in this scenario, holding a discretionary referendum can depoliticize a clearly political choice by transforming the decision from a political one to a popular one, from the decision of legislators and executives to a decision made by the people. This was the case of Brexit in 2016. The Prime Minister at the time felt compelled as a political matter to promise a referendum as a way to placate the strong anti-EU forces in his party. Now, as we know today, the Prime Minister severely miscalculated the odds of winning the referendum, and now we see the consequences for the UK, for Europe, and for the world. Which leads to a third reason for a discretionary referendum, and that's to usher in historic changes to the Constitution. When leaders propose transformative reforms to the Constitution, they don't often want to make this massive change without securing the approval of the people. And that was the case in Colombia in 2016, when the president organized a plebiscite on the new peace pact with the FARC. So these are three reasons why leaders use discretionary referendums. They may be good reasons, they may be bad reasons, but in either case, the point is that the discretionary referendum is an irregular device because it raises concerns for the rule of law. Concerns for the rule of law, even though we associate referendums with democracy. Now, you might be asking, how can it be that a referendum would raise a concern for the rule of law? Well, here we can look to the Venice Commission. The Venice Commission has taken a position on discretionary referendums, and it is uncomfortable with procedures that defy the rules of change that are codified in the Constitution. And so the Venice Commission has insisted that political leaders should not use discretionary referendums to circumvent the codified rules of change, and instead that political leaders should adhere strictly to the rules of change that are codified in the Constitution. And so I want to make a prediction. I want to make a prediction now about what we'll see in the next generation of constitutional change. I think despite the concerns that many people have about the use of discretionary referendums around the world, we see that they're increasingly common in the world. And my prediction is that they will continue to be widely used in the decades ahead. And the reason why has everything to do with legitimacy, a very specific kind of legitimacy, sociological legitimacy. By sociological legitimacy, I mean legitimacy that comes from the people themselves, because there's no greater source of legitimacy than the people themselves in the Lockean theory of consent. Popular consent has a powerful salience in political rhetoric and in political reality, because when a leader proclaims to speak for the people, and when she can point to evidence of the people's support, that creates a kind of insulation for the leader against charges of abuse or misuse of the powers of constitutional change. And so this, I think, is one of my predictions for the future. But before we turn to a second subject in constitutional design, let me say one more thing about referendums. I think the fact that I believe we'll see more referendums in the future, especially discretionary referendums in the future, this is an opportunity for new thinking about constitutional design. It's an opportunity to think about how we should design referendums. Surely, in my view, referendums should not be a single vote on a single day with a 50% plus one majority winning the day. That may be democratic, but only in the most unsophisticated majoritarian understanding of democracy. I think that referendums, in order to be truly democratic, should entail some assurances, some protections for democracy. A deliberative exchange of views by opposing sides, opportunities for the electorate to learn about the stakes of their choice, to allow them to become properly informed, public funding to the different camps advocating for and against the referendum, and perhaps for a confirmatory vote after an initial approval vote, not unlike what we see in the Scandinavian model of constitutional reform. And finally, five, perhaps a heightened threshold for success beyond just 50% plus one in order to provide protection for minority groups. So I think that the next generation of constitutional design should attend to these protections for democracy in the use of referendums, because referendums are here and they're here to stay. And so we should prepare to hold them fairly, deliberatively, consistent with the highest expectations of electoral integrity and also of public education. So that's the first trend I expect to see in the future in the next generation of constitutional design. Let's move on now to the second theme for us to consider. How will constitutionalism and constitutional design manage the tension between the local and the global, between national domestic commitments and global values in the world? I think that in the future, we'll see more countries incorporate global values into their domestic constitution, because countries will seek to build or rebuild their constitution atop a regime of international human rights protection. And over time, this will bring the peoples of the world closer together through shared values, values that cross national boundaries, values that are transnational, values that are universal. But the question will be how? How will domestic constitutions incorporate global values? How will domestic constitutions integrate global values into their architecture, into their DNA? Well, there are three models that I think we will see grow in prominence in the next 30 to 40 years. Three models for constitutional design. Constitutional design that respects international human rights, that respects the dignity of all persons, and that advances the global values of public law. Three models. Model one is what we can describe as a judicial mandate. In this model, the Constitution puts the onus on courts to ensure respect for the global values of international human rights. Model two is a prohibition on constitutional amendment. And here, the Constitution outright, flatly prohibits amendments that violate the global values of international human rights. And model three is what you can understand as a supranational requirement. And in this case, the Constitution would subordinate itself to a body of supranational law that requires all actors and all actions to promote the global values of international human rights. So let me give you some examples of each of these models. The Model 1 judicial mandate, I think here, the Constitution of South Africa is a good example. Because under this model in South Africa, what the court does, what the Constitution does, is that the Constitution sets some rules about how the Constitutional Court must interpret the Bill of Rights. And here's what the Constitution says on this point. Section 39 of the Constitution of South Africa says that when interpreting the Bill of Rights, the court must consider international law. What this means is that South African judges must interpret the rights in the domestic Bill of Rights with reference to the global law of international human rights. And this is a mandatory rule. Judges must look to global values in order to give meaning to local rights like the right to equality, the right to be free from torture, the right to adequate housing, the right to assembly, just to give a few examples. That's an example of the Model 1 example of a judicial mandate of how we can integrate global values into domestic national constitutions. Model 2 is to prohibit certain constitutional amendments. This Model 2 strategy incorporates global values of international human rights into national constitutions by limiting the power of constitutional amendment. How? By prohibiting amendments that violate the global values of international law and international human rights. And a good example of this Model 2 strategy is Switzerland. The Swiss Constitution authorizes its own amendment and even its own replacement. But whether the Swiss Constitution is amended or replaced, it is necessary, it's a rule, that the global values and the rules of international law must always be respected, because the text of the Swiss Constitution says that no amendment may violate the global values of international law, nor may any new constitution violate international law. And so you see, this Model 2 strategy of prohibiting amendments is another way that we can design constitutions to try to protect the global values of international human rights. So far, we've discussed two models, two strategies that national constitutions use to incorporate global values. And just remember, this is part of my second prediction for the future of constitutional change. My second prediction is that we'll see more constitutions around the world adopting these different strategies. The Model 1 strategy that requires courts to interpret the Constitution consistent with international human rights law. The Model 2 strategy that entails prohibiting certain kinds of amendments that violate international human rights. And now the final model, Model 3. Model 3 is quite simply a supranational requirement. Under Model 3, a constitution incorporates supranational law and gives precedence to that supranational law. What this means is that the supranational law applies across the entire jurisdiction to require all actors in the country and all actions made by those actors to respect the global values of international human rights. And the best example, I think, of this Model 3 supranational requirement is the Constitution of Bosnia and Herzegovina. Why? Well, because this constitution is deeply rooted in these global values of international law. The preamble declares its commitment to the UN Charter. The preamble declares that it's inspired by the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, as well as other multilateral instruments. And the very first article of the Constitution of Bosnia and Herzegovina requires the country to remain a member state of the United Nations and all that that entails. And then if you look into the text of the Constitution, beyond the preamble, beyond the first article, you'll see the Bill of Rights. And the Bill of Rights itself commits the country to ensuring the highest level of internationally recognized human rights and fundamental freedoms. And the way that the Constitution does this, the way the Constitution puts this commitment into operation, is by declaring that the rights and freedoms in the European Convention on Human Rights will apply directly in Bosnia and Herzegovina. So you have here a direct application of the values of an international convention on rights applying directly into the national country, into the jurisdiction, the domestic jurisdiction. It's quite interesting design for a constitution. The entire constitutional order in Bosnia and Herzegovina is built around this commitment to global values of international human rights. In fact, the Constitution declares that these European convention rights will have priority over all other laws, including domestic laws. It's quite an extraordinary commitment. And if you look even further down into the text of the Constitution of Bosnia and Herzegovina, what you'll find is that there is a list of international human rights agreements that are identified over and above the European Convention on Human Rights as having direct application in the country. So there's an appendix that says these international human rights instruments will apply directly in Bosnia and Herzegovina. It's quite remarkable to see that. And so this is a Model 3 strategy of supranational rules integrated into the domestic constitution to promote global values of international human rights. Now, none of these models is perfect, but I think all three models are worth considering by any country that really seeks to make a real commitment to global values. Okay, so I've given you my first prediction about referendums, and now my second prediction I've now completed, which is that you will see around the world in the years ahead, you will see more constitutions incorporating these kinds of strategies to advance global values. The Model 1 strategy that we saw in South Africa, the Model 2 strategy that we saw in Switzerland, and the Model 3 strategy that we saw in Bosnia and Herzegovina. We will see more of these in the future. And now, let me come to the third and final theme in our discussion today about the next generation of constitutional design. And the third theme for us to discuss is connected to the rule of law. And here's the theme. Let me put the theme in the form of a question. What will the rule of law demand for a proper, valid, and legitimate process of constitutional revision? And here, I'm not going to offer a prediction. I instead want to offer a prescription, a recommendation for new constitutions. If you look around the world over the past 40, 50 years, what you will have seen is that reformers in every corner of the world are exploiting the forms and limits of constitutional amendment. They're testing the limits of law. They're pushing the boundaries of the Constitution. And there's growing evidence that leaders are looking for ways to extend the life of their constitutions beyond their natural lifespan. What this means is that rather than mounting an effort to create a new constitution when the Constitution has outlived its purpose, leaders in every region of the globe instead use the procedures of constitutional amendment to transform the Constitution into something completely unrecognizable. It's as though they were creating a new Constitution using the rules of constitutional amendment. Now, These kinds of changes are often called constitutional amendments, and they're presented to the people as constitutional amendments. And they're passed using the procedures of constitutional amendment. But they're but they're not amendments at all. They're something else. They are what I want to describe to you as a constitutional dismemberment, not an amendment. What's a dismemberment? Well, I think the best way to understand what a dismemberment is first to understand what an amendment is. So let me tell you what an amendment is, properly defined. A constitutional amendment, properly defined, is a change to the Constitution that keeps the Constitution coherent and consistent. An amendment continues the Constitution-making project in line with the existing design of the Constitution. It entails unbroken unity with the Constitution. And an amendment to be an amendment does not push the boundaries of the Constitution any further than its outermost limits. That's an amendment. But what we've been seeing around the world in the last half century is often not amendment. It's instead dismemberment of the Constitution. The effect of a constitutional dismemberment is to unmake the existing Constitution, all the while keeping legal continuity. Because you see, dismemberments are self-conscious efforts to repudiate the essential characteristics of the Constitution and to destroy its foundations. These kinds of changes dismantle the basic structure of the Constitution, and they entail substantial consequences for the whole of law and society, because what they do is that they destroy and reconstruct the Constitution simultaneously. And so what happens is that the Constitution seems entirely new, even though political actors have used the procedures of constitutional amendment to remake it. We've seen this happen all around the world, in the Americas, in Africa, in Asia, in Europe, in civil law countries and common law countries, in presidential regimes and parliamentary regimes, in the global north and global south, everywhere. It's a common phenomenon. The point I want to stress is that a constitutional dismemberment is really a transformative change to a constitution that exceeds the boundaries of that constitution. It's a fundamental transformation of the constitution's core commitments because it alters the identity, fundamental rights, or the basic structure of the constitution. Now, here's the problem. The problem is that reformers around the world routinely pass constitutional dismemberments using the procedures of constitutional amendment, and they should not be permitted to do that, because an amendment is a small-scale change to the Constitution, and a dismemberment is a large-scale change to the Constitution, and there should be different procedures for each. Easier procedures for amendment, harder procedures for dismemberment. Think of it in terms of a hierarchy of constitutional rigidity. At the low end of the scale, it's relatively easy to make changes to the Constitution because what we're doing is amending the Constitution in a way that does not transform the Constitution. That's an amendment. At the high end of the scale, it should be very difficult to make changes to the Constitution because these are the changes that will impact the most important core features of the Constitution. These kinds of changes should require a higher threshold of approval and ratification, a greater depth and durability of agreement, and more points of entry for popular deliberation, for popular input and popular consent. This high-end threshold, that should be reserved for constitutional dismemberment. So what you have are two ends of the scale. And if you think of a constitutional design of amendment rules, you would have at least two different procedures of change. Procedures for amendment, procedures for dismemberment, and you can have procedures in between for changes that are moderate in their difficulty, and that correspond to the moderately important parts of the Constitution. We see this form of constitutional change design. We see it in some countries around the world. Some countries around the world have constitutions that have two different procedures of amendment or dismemberment, three, four, five. In my home country of Canada, we have five procedures of change. Easy, a little bit harder, a little bit harder, very difficult, impossible. So here's a key point in designing this escalating hierarchy of constitutional change. The choice about which part or principle of the Constitution should require which threshold of change, that's a choice that should be made by the designers of the Constitution at the point of constitutional creation. And so I mentioned that I would not be making a prediction here, that I'd be giving a prescription. So I'm not predicting to you that countries in the next generation will adopt this model of constitutional change, but they should. They should. They wouldn't be the first to do so. We see this escalating model of constitutional change in Austria and Ecuador and Spain, several countries around the world. And this model has advantages of clarity, predictability, and transparency. It also succeeds in differentiating constitutional rules according to their importance, making it clear which values in the Constitution matter more or less in the constitutional community. So, this should be part of the future of constitutional design. It should be part of the next generation of constitutional design. We began with three questions, and here I'm going to close. One each about democracy, constitutionalism, and the rule of law. What role will democracy play in constitutional design? Well, I predict that we'll see more direct democratic activity in constitutional amendments, most notably with the use of referendums around the world. And so constitutional designers should codify rules for referendums with attention to fostering fair, full, free, and informed popular participation. Second, how will constitutionalism and constitutional design manage the tension between the local and the global, between national commitments in the domestic constitution and global values in the world? Well, here, I predict that we'll see more constitutions adopting something like the South African model, or something like the Swiss model, or something like the Bosnian and Herzegovinian model, in order to try to integrate global values into their domestic constitution. And finally, third, what will the rule of law demand for a proper, valid, and legitimate process of constitutional revision? And on this point, you'll recall I didn't make a prediction. Instead, I offered a recommendation for constitutional designers, a recommendation for how to find a way to balance flexibility with rigidity in constitutional design by adopting an escalating structure of constitutional change that distinguishes between amendment and dismemberment. So let me now close with four different things. First, again, to Airlangga University for inviting me to give this lecture. Second, to Professor Bajri for hosting today's discussion and for being here with us today. And third, to my friends at Airlangga, Professors Rosa and Radion, for this splendid opportunity. And fourth, to all of you for being here and for your interest. I look forward to your comments and your questions, and I look forward to continuing our conversation after this virtual discussion ends. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Professor Richard Albert. I have to note that it is always interesting lecture for me, for us here, because two reasons. One, always very systematic. The second is you bring us to the grassroots level with an example from a comparative perspective. So you always give an example, actual example in your lecture. Now I invite all participants to raise a question, or you may have some point to be discussed with Professor Albert. You may raise your hand and then, or you may just write in the chat in Bahasa is okay, then Professor Richard Albert will respond. I see here one of the participants, Giza Jati. You may speak, or you want to, yes, please, if you want to speak directly, please.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Radian, for the chance for me. Oh, thanks. Thank you, Dr. Radian, for the chance for me. Hello, my name is Giza Jati Pamoro. I'm a student from Airlangga University, study program Master of Science in Law and Development. But before, I'm sorry for not use a mask because I at home right now. I think in home safest place for in the world for fighting COVID-19. But in the topic, it's very nice. The next generation of constitutional design. I want to ask you, Prof. Richard Albert, and maybe Dr. Adrian too, about in Article 7 in 1945 Constitution state term of office. It means employment period of the president and vice president is valid for 5 years. And after that, they can be re-elected only once for the same term. And I want to ask, if the president and vice president have been in office for 10 years, and then the election is postponed for 1 or 2 years, so that they still serve up to 11 or 12 years on the ground and it is still a COVID pandemic, is that a violation of the Constitution or not? Thank you, Prof. and Dr. Adrian.
Okay, Professor Richard, question from Giza Jati is an actual issue here in Indonesia that President of Jokowi already will now in the second term of office, and some politicians have an idea that we may postpone a next election on the ground of a COVID-19 pandemic. So maybe you may have a comment concerning in relation with your topic with this issue, please.
Yeah, well, thank you very much for the question. Before I answer, let me just share with everyone in the chat box. This is a link to a book that I've written on constitutional amendment. You're welcome to have a look at it and read it and download it. And if you have any questions and comments on it, I'd be really interested to hear them. So please do have a look if it interests you, because a lot of the ideas that I've been speaking about are developed at greater length in that book. It's a book called Constitutional Amendments, Making, Breaking, and Changing Constitutions, published in 2019 by Oxford University Press. So the question is one, I think, of current interest in Indonesia. And I think it's just difficult to have a blanket rule that says any delay, any postponement to ordinarily scheduled elections is a violation of the Constitution. Perhaps as a strictly legal matter, if the Constitution does not authorize a delay or postponement or revision to the election dates, perhaps strictly legally, it may be a violation of the law of the Constitution, but it may be outweighed by necessity. I'm not making a comment here that that's the case in Indonesia, but I do know from world experience in earlier moments of emergency that there have been cases where elections have been postponed because of crises. I can think of my own country, Canada. We had an election that was supposed to be held no later than the year 1916. But instead it was held in 1917. And this is a result of the First World War at the time. And in the United States, there was a rule. I'm standing now in the United States where I work. In the United States, once upon a time, it was an accepted convention that no president would run for re-election more than once. So the president would run, serve 4 years, and then if she wanted to, he wanted to, would run again for a second four-year term, and that would be it. But as you may know, in the Second World War, then President Franklin Delano Roosevelt broke from that convention, and he ran for a second re-election, making it 3 terms. And that wasn't it. He then ran for a third re-election, giving him 4 terms. And the justification was that this was a moment of emergency, a moment of crisis. And so I don't think that we can ascribe, that we can generate one universal rule about when it's appropriate or not to delay elections, to postpone elections in the face of a pandemic. We have to really look case by case and examine the history of the place, examine carefully the text of the Constitution, and also examine what the circumstances are in that specific jurisdiction in dealing with the crisis, in this case, the pandemic. Now, I will say one more thing. The pandemic is something that has affected all countries around the world. And there have been many countries that have successfully held elections during the pandemic. The United States, just last year. Canada, right now, is holding an election. Many countries around the world have held elections during the pandemic. So they're showing that it's possible to do it in a way that is safe, that is secure, and that respects the highest ideals of democratic integrity. So again, I'm not making a comment on the case in Indonesia, I'm just giving you a perspective from around the world.
Okay, thank you, Professor Albert. In the chat, there is a quick question from Sam. I may read it. Assuming we are creating or designing a constitution from scratch after a regime was toppled, how does a new constitution earn its legitimacy? Yeah.
Assuming a constitution is created from scratch after a regime is toppled, how does the new constitution earn its legitimacy? Well, here, maybe we can distinguish between what we mean by toppling a regime. Do we mean toppling in a democratic revolution? Do we mean toppling in a coup that then becomes effective in reshaping the infrastructure of government? So let's distinguish between the two, but let's assume that what Sam is asking about is starting from scratch after a democratic revolution. How then does a new constitution earn its legitimacy? Well, here there are a number of ways that the constitution can earn its legitimacy, and we can distinguish 3 different kinds of legitimacy. The first kind of legitimacy that the constitution could say it has is a certain legal legitimacy, by which I mean that the constitution can be legitimated by the very fact that it has followed the procedure set out by political actors to create, to negotiate, and then to promulgate the Constitution. If all of the rules are followed, and then the Constitution comes into being, then we can say that it's a legally legitimate Constitution because it follows the rules of law. But that might not be satisfactory to you. You might not be satisfied with that kind of legitimacy, because you may quite rightly say that not all law is good law. Just because something is legally legitimate doesn't make it right. I can pass a law that says everyone who wears glasses shall be fined $50, and failure to pay the fine will result in imprisonment. That's a law. That's not a legitimate law in the same way. It's legally legitimate, but it's not a good law. So let's say that the Constitution that we're talking about, let's say that it could have legal legitimacy, but that really is not the highest kind of legitimacy that we can aspire to. There are two other kinds of legitimacy that I think are better candidates for legitimizing a constitution that is created from scratch, let's say after a democratic revolution. The first is what we can call sociological legitimacy, popular legitimacy. And here that would mean that the constitution is legitimate because it has the consent of the governed. The people accept the constitution as theirs, they embrace it, either because they participated in its writing, because they participated in its deliberation, because they participated in ratifying it in a referendum or some combination of the others or some other points. The point, however, the deep point, is that the second kind of legitimacy is a sociological, popular legitimacy that is a higher form of legitimacy than just legal legitimacy, because here you have the consent of the governed legitimating the Constitution. But nonetheless, you might say, well, that's still not the best kind of legitimacy, is it? Because just as a law can be unjust, the people themselves can make unjust decisions. So just because the people are behind an idea, a constitution, doesn't mean that that constitution is a good constitution, right? The people may choose to do something bad. And so this leads us to a third kind of legitimacy, which is moral legitimacy. Moral legitimacy is distinct from legal and sociological legitimacy because it's not concerned with procedure, and it's not concerned with popular consent. It's concerned with what is right. It's concerned with the values of constitutionalism, of democracy, and of public law. And so that's the third way that we can evaluate the legitimacy of a constitution. Is it morally legitimate? But this, of course, also holds some problems. The problem is, what is moral and what is not? You and I might disagree about what is morally proper and what is morally improper. Your good may be my evil. And so there's a problem not only with legal legitimacy, not only with popular or sociological legitimacy, but also with moral legitimacy. So the answer to your question, Sam, how do we evaluate the legitimacy of a new constitution that emerges from a democratic revolution? I think it has to be a combination of all three. It has to be some combination of all three, because we have to respect a process. The people must have some say in its acceptance and its ratification, and it must be a constitution that orients the people to a positive mission of good and justice and fairness and equality. So very, very difficult question, but I hope I've been able to begin to address it for you.
Okay, thank you, Professor Richard. Is there any question, or maybe one question or response? If there is no, I have a comment, Professor Albert, about your second point.
I think we
point.
Have one question in the chat box, yeah.
In the chat box, oh wait. Okay. From Dinori Aritona, when we consider the Constitution as an adaptive law, especially in favor of public interest, in case of the Constitution is silent, how can we interpret the Constitution constitutionally? Who has the power to interpret and manage the silence of the Constitution? Yeah.
Yes, this is a fascinating question because it's a problem that all constitutions confront. No constitution is a complete code. All constitutions admit of silences. All of them do. Nothing is ever written down fully. And in fact, in my own view, a written constitution, a truly written constitution, is an impossibility. It's impossible to always and write everything down. And so the question arises, what do we do when there are silences? And we've come up with a couple of different ways of managing this problem. One way of managing the problem is by having the silences filled, the gaps of the Constitution filled by an actor. And this is the Constitutional Court or the High Court, or the judiciary more generally. In the course of constitutional litigation about a matter in the jurisdiction that the constitutional text does not address or does not address clearly, we turn to courts to resolve the problem for us and to tell us what the Constitution allows, what the silence really should say. And the second option that we've come up with is not to look to courts, but instead to have legislators pass laws that put into operation the constitutional values by filling in the gaps in the text of the Constitution by ordinary statute. And so these are the two models that we've seen around the world, in the democratic world, where there's respect for the rule of law, there's respect for democracy and democratic procedures. So we either turn to courts or we turn to legislators to do it. The question is simply, which do you prefer? There are values that I think stand in good stead, the courts doing it. There are values that I think militate in favor of the legislature doing it by statute. In either case, however, you see that democracies have innovated these ways of dealing with this problem that confronts every single constitution in the world.
Okay, thank you. If you don't mind, one response from me, Professor Albert, but your second point concerning issue global values. My question is then, why national or domestic constitution must integrate or incorporate with global values? Then the question is, what in a question from the perspective of national constitution is, what is then benefit for a national state to incorporate global values? Because sometimes that we always say that constitution earn its legitimacy from the local, not from the global. So you may respond about this.
Yes, I do want to respond to that, because I think Professor Radion, you've put your question, your finger, I think, on a central question in this debate about global values and domestic constitutions. You're quite right that the conventional understanding of a domestic constitution is that it's a constitution bordered by a set of rules that is impenetrable by external rules. The idea being that a constitution is a unique set of rules that are formed in a jurisdiction, that apply in that jurisdiction, and that are accepted in that jurisdiction. And so you're asking, well, what about the problem of imposing values from outside the jurisdiction into the domestic constitution? I want to be very clear, which is to say that I understand the problem you're raising. I want to be very clear that I'm sensitive to your point. It's a concern that I certainly share. But there are rules that I'm sure you and I can agree should govern how constitutional democracies operate across the board. For example, there should be free and fair elections always, right? Right? I think we can agree that every jurisdiction should have free and fair elections with informed voters, right? That, I think, is getting us close to a kind of a global value. I'm not talking about things that have to do with matters of conscience. No, I'm not talking about things that have to do with problems that really pierce deeply into the soul of a people. I'm really talking about the very basic minimum understanding of the things that you and I and the people of the world share in terms of our aspirations for the democracies of the world. That's what I'm talking about. And in this case, you can understand that incorporating these global values of how we do constitutionalism, how we do democracy, that it will be welcomed, should be welcomed, I think, in my view, by all the peoples of the world in a way that respects what they do internally in their own jurisdiction, but that has regard for the standards that we expect all constitutional democracies to abide by. It's like being part of a club. Every club has rules and expectations. They're not always onerous rules. In this case, I don't think they're onerous rules. But the point is that if you want to be part of the club, it comes with some responsibilities. And one of those responsibilities is to adhere to a minimum understanding of what the standards are for a constitutional democracy, including free and fair elections. Let me put something in the text for all of you, by the way. There is a international learned society called the International Society of Public Law. It's abbreviated ICON-S. And it's a society that is really global, operates around the world. I'm involved in the society, and we hold a number of events around the world, and we have a number of chapters around the world in different countries and regions. And we do events where we invite people to come together in person and online to exchange ideas about not only constitutions and constitutional law, but public law values more generally, like administrative law, like international law, like constitutional law. So if this interests you at all, click on the link and have a look and get involved. We'd love to hear from you.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Richard Arpet. I think for us, Friday morning here, this lecture is a refreshment and also enlightenment for us. But the issue you already raised in the future of next generation of constitutional design. Before arriving at the end of this session, I give back to Dr. Rosa. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Radia, and so good to see you. And thank you also for your question. I look forward to seeing you in person when we can talk a bit about it more and exchange ideas. And let me just say, if anyone really is interested in talking more about these ideas, you can also contact me directly. You have my email address, and I'm happy to exchange ideas with you. If you want to exchange ideas on Twitter, you can do that. This is my Twitter account. Here is my email address. I'll just put it in the chat box. And please stay in touch, and I look forward to hearing from you. Thank you again, Professor Radia.
Okay. Thank you so much, Richard, Professor Richard Arpet. Well, actually, I have one quick remark, general remark for your public lecture, Richard. This is a very great topic, actually, because I myself this year I have a research on the smaller level of value, constitutionalism value, which is I have research on regional value on constitutionalism. So actually, I'm very curious on your opinion about maybe this kind of constitutional tradition, which you may predict that it will be convergence, it will be a convergency of some point of constitutional value, right? So on the other hand, there will be like still the diversity of constitutional tradition will be still preserved. That's maybe your, if I understand your point on this lecture, right, Richard?
I think that's absolutely right, Professor Rosa. You're quite right, and I look forward to reading your work about this because I'm glad you're researching it, and it'll be an opportunity for me to learn from you about this subject. But yes, I think that's right. I see a convergence around the world that will happen in the next generations, countries and constitutions beginning to look a lot more like in terms of how they respect global values of international human rights law.
Okay.
While at the same time keeping their own distinct identity,
yes,
as domestic jurisdictions that have their own local value. So what I'm suggesting is that we'll see a balancing of the local with the global.
Global.
The global,
yes,
will not dominate over the local.
Okay.
They'll be acting in concert. It'll
equal,
be like a dance.
Right?
Yes. I don't know if it's equal, but it'll be like a dance. So in some issues, the global will predominate. In others, the local will predominate. You may also see that sometimes countries will want to be part of supranational institutions, regional entities that impose requirements for what their constitutions must say. In that case, they have no choice. They have to put that value in their constitution. So you're quite right. There will be a tension between the local and the global, and that I think is inevitable.
Yeah, I think it's really, really interesting issue. So I look forward to discuss with you more, and
me too.
maybe for the next public lecture there will be a further discussion about this topic again. So thank you again, Professor Richard Albert, for giving us a public lecture as usual. As the starting lecture in this new academic year. So I hope it will be an encouragement, enlightenment for all of us, for all of the participants, and for all of the students, yeah, bringing a new idea of this topic. So thank you again for all, for the participants, and thank you for the team, digital team, and also, yeah. Thank you very much, Professor Richard Albert, and have a good time. Night.
Thank you very much.
Good night.
I also just want to thank your digital team as well. I know how complicated it is to set up an event like this, and so let me just please thank them for all they've done to make this possible. And just one last thanks to everyone at Airlangga for welcoming me with such open arms. I was there in November 2019, and I had a wonderful visit with all of you, especially with Professors Rosa and Radian. And now as a member of your visiting faculty, it's just an honor for me to be part of your community. So
it's
thank you very,
us.
Very much for that.
It's an honor for us, Professor Richard Albert, for being our visiting professor this year, and I hope next year will be the same, will be the same scheme. Thank you so much, Professor Richard Albert, and thank you everyone. Stay safe, everyone, and good morning and good evening, Richard, there. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye. See you, Richard.
Bye.
Terima kasih, Bapak-Ibu semuanya.